what was the kind of the core concept we were trying to convey. Or, you know, I saw there was a lot of reference to the online video instruction, and there was like EDM music kind of performance there as well. So maybe you also talk about those kind of pop culture influence to your work as well.
Hello, I'm Lu Yang. Thanks for everyone's coming. I made in 2015. And 我就说中文吧。
So I was thinking if I can invite some machine that is multi-point stimulation in the deep brain, is that going to stimulate the human into a god?
所以一开始他有一个这样的概念，然后就把一个，因为我的很多作品里面都是和大脑有关，然后是用一些我们现今技术上已经可以达到的一些技术，去。 把它做一些改变，或者是做一些探讨，比如说这个DBS技术，然后还有片子里面还出现了一个技术叫 TMS， 就是 transcranial magnetic stimulation.
A lot of the concept that I use in my work is related to the brain. I was talking about all the techniques that is available to the medical world. So you see the DBS is used in a lot of the surgical process, and also I talked about another technique that is TMS.
TMS. 然后 TMS， 我有另外一件作品，它就是专门关于 TMS 技术的。然后我在也是在一个学校里面的实验室里面。
Oh, I have another work about the TMS technique. I created that work in a lab in a school.
然后我就把这个 TMS 当就是替换成就是，因为我很喜欢看恐怖片，尤其是那种宗教驱魔的片子。
I love horror movies and especially the religious horror movies.
然后就是
about ghost fighting.
像就是像以前人们以为的，就是之后对于这种被鬼魂附身的这样子一些事例，他们说有可能是你的精神疾病，就比如说那个叫做那个有一种精神疾病，它叫综合什么秽语什么什么那个什么torture syndrome，就一天到晚骂人的那个疾病。So
In the past, people believe that if a ghost is passed onto someone's body, so you are not behaving like yourself, and now we are believing that is a mental disease instead of a ghost. So there used to be a... So there is a type of disease that when people get it, people will not stop cursing others.
They will speak a lot, dirty words. Yeah. 然后那个 TMS 技术，它就是可以影响人的语言中枢，它可以在一个人说话的时候去终止他说话，或者是让他说不出来那一句话。
So the TMS technique is used to basically change the language technique of a person to stop someone from talking about something or stop someone from using a sentence.
所以刚才说了那么多这些那些的技术，就是我一直在想，我们现在可以看到的，我们可以用技术去影响一个人的性格，或者是影响一个人的行为模式的话，那就究竟人有没有意识、自由意志和那个灵魂？So
if we can already see that technology can change a person's personality and character as well as their behavior, then is there a really a free will, or is there any spirituality that we have?
所以就是在那个 delusional mind 那里面，它主要就是在探讨的一个问题，就是意识的来源。So
the core concept is where our conceptualizing comes from.
然后包括后面的一些探讨关于人类情绪控制中枢，比如说我们有一个叫 limbic system， 它是和我们的情绪很有关的一个。
So we are also talking about the area of our brain that controls our mood.
然后就是，所以我对这些正面的或者负面的这些情绪，尤其是负面的情绪也是非常感兴趣。包括我以前就是做的一个作品叫做 Rust for King Kong， 然后之前 Barbara 那个他测的展里面也有这件作品，他主要是说的是关于愤怒这种情绪。
So I'm very interested in the positive and negative emotional responses of humans. In one of my past work,
Rest for King Kong Horror,
and I was talking about anger as the passive emotion.
因为愤怒这个情绪在佛教里面，它是一个非常重要的一个情绪，它是可以把人带向地狱的一种情绪。
In Buddhism, anger is a very important emotion because anger will bring you to hell in Buddhism.
但是你从脑科学的角度去看的话，要触发人的愤怒这种情绪，它有不同的大脑的通路。But
if you talk about neuroscience, there are different paths connecting to anger, this emotion.
就是，所以就我的很多作品都是和大脑情绪或者是心理学。
So a lot of my work is connected to brain emotion as well as psychology.
然后就是大家看到的用一些电子乐或者是 pop culture 去包装这些作品，就完全是因为我平时自己放松自己的方式吧。因为制作作品的过程很枯燥，所以就选择一些觉得自己觉得有意思的方式去包装，就这样会有做作品的乐趣。
You see that I put it into a EDM, electronic dance music package, because the process of creating artwork like mine is very dull. So whenever I relax, I like entertaining methods such as EDM. So I'm just using these EDM and also techniques to make my work making more interesting.
然后就是刚才忘记说了，就在比如说曼达里面比较重要的一部分就是。 可能很大一部分也在说佛教里面说的一个关键的一个万物循环的一个规律，就是成住坏空。里面关于疾病还有死亡这部分描写也是非常多的。So
in Buddhism there is a lot of discussion about the death and also our disease. There is a concept in Buddhism everywhere.
成住坏空 is how we get first and the stay in this world and the disappear then. 然后就是，所以然后里面还有一个比较关键的，我觉得可能大家有点看不懂，就是有关于内脏的一些，就是有一副新的内脏，然后会换到一副比较旧的内脏，然后再诉说一些比较内脏可能发生的一些比较负面的词汇。
So, and one of the important concepts in the work that you may not have understood is when you see the organs, and there is a new set of organs changed by an old set of organs, and they are talking about the passiveness of our organ.
然后其实在里面说的这些词汇里面, 它是有36个词汇。
And there are 36 different words talking about organs.
然后这36个词汇其实是我的灵感在佛教里面的一种, 就是它的一种观想方法, 叫做不净观, 就是不干净的意思, 不干净。
So there is a meditation method in Buddhism that is about the meditation about and cleanness.
就是你要一直在观想自己的身体是由各种各样污秽所组成，然后你才可以放下对于这个身体的执着。
You're looking into your body and realizing that your body is created by something that is so unclean, and that way you will give up the possession to your body.
然后就是，所以在创作这个作品的过程中，就是一直去看这些东西，去想这些东西。我觉得可能对于自己的这个，就是对于这种过程，好像也是在修炼的一个过程。The
process for me is also a practice.
然后后面有一个画面，就是我把自己放进了一个灵车里面，就。 那个灵车它是，我就在想，就是多媒体现在运用在很多方面，那就是比如说葬礼啊什么的，也可以用多媒体的话，那可能可以更有意思一点，更有用嘛，这个多媒体艺术。
And the end, I put myself into a coffin and the funeral card. So I was thinking maybe multimedia could be applied to different areas. For example, for funeral, you can use multimedia for your funeral. And that is the multimedia creation, the video is your funeral.
然后就是最后这一段会很长，这一段片段很长，是其实是主要是为了展示在这个灵车上面的一段文字，所以就是如果说看不懂中文的会比较奇怪，为什么这一个片段会那么长。
So that shot is quite long because I would like to showcase the wording on that funeral card. And if you don't understand or read Chinese, you may wonder why that scene is so long.
这也是那段文字是佛陀他就是对于这个世界成住坏空的一个表述，就比如说生者必死，成那个高者必堕，就是他所有的就是这样的一个循环。So
that that past paragraph in the funeral card is about Buddhism's wording about birth and disease and death. So once you're born, you will die eventually.
就或者是所有的好的东西，它都有可能是有一个这样起伏的一个过程。
And all goodness and all positive things will have a different curve, and that will go up and down and increase and decrease.
Great. 差不多就这样。
Thank you.
Thank you for your long answer to my short questions. And I have many follow-up questions related to ethics, abjection, maybe taboo. But before I follow up, maybe we should turn to Barbara. And I know you wrote about Yun's work, exhibit her work in your exhibition, in your book. So maybe help us to contextualize Yun's practice within maybe her generation of artists, such as Guan Xiao, Miao Ying, maybe slightly older generation, Cao Fei. Kind of help us to situate her within her peers.
Yes, I'm a big fan. Lu Yang is the first artist I write about in my new book because I think that she's so representative of the top of her generation. She's like distilled it all down into these words that are really questioning identity and who we are, down to brain chemistry. It's no longer an analysis of identity based on geographic boundaries or national boundaries or cultural heritage. It's an analysis of identity that comes from something really core. And in order to make her work, she is in touch with neuroscientists all over the world, all the time in chat rooms on the internet, to and doing residencies at universities in order to make this work. It's a very different way of doing an inquiry as an artist than being alone in your studio and just thinking about who you are in more limited terms. I think that she's also an interesting pivotal figure because there were a couple of artists that came before her in terms of new media and digital art, such as Xia Fei, who did a lot of work in this area. But Lu Yang takes this and moves it to the next level. In fact, one work of hers that I just want to touch on briefly, that is the first work of art, I opened my book talking about it, is a piece she made called Uterus Man. And this is a superhero, an androgynous superhero, who all of his powers come from female reproductive organs. So he has an electric umbilical cord, and he can change the DNA makeup of his enemies. And she made this into a full-fledged video game that you can play. It's operational and interactive. And so you go through this game trying to acquire these superpowers, and it's a view of identity that goes even beyond binary gender identity to something that's much more contemporary and fluid. And so I find her as one of the most interesting artists, not just in China, but even in terms of artists I see here in the United States, in terms of looking at issues of identity.
Do you have anything to add to that, Lu Yang, about identity, and maybe tell us more about the uterus man? I saw that video very briefly before as well. And also it's become a video game, right?
Right.
Yeah. So maybe just tell everyone a bit more.
就是 uterus man 就是其实是一个2013年完成的作品，然后 很多人看了这件作品之后，会觉得这是一个女权色彩非常重的一个作品。
Uterus Man was finished in 2003. A lot of people, after viewing this work, think it's a feminist work.
但其实我的出发点和女权完全没有关系。
But my original thought has nothing to do with feminism.
就像 Barbara 说的，就是我不想给，就是不想。 在任何一个局限里面去做作品，或者是任何一个话题里面去做作品。So
because just as Barbara said, I don't want to limit myself to any of the topics, or I don't want to give myself an area of limitation.
所以其实这件作品它是不是在一个就是男的或是女的这样子一个性别框架里面去做的一个作品。So
it was created under a non-binary concept. There was no female or male gender.
然后这件作品的人物设定，那个Uterus Man，他其实是一个没有性别的人，但是他外表看上去是一个少年。So
the main character is asexual. However, the appearance of the main character is a young teenager boy.
然后他用的一些技能就是可能和子宫是有关的，但就是其实是我做这个作品就是一个讽刺。
So the main skills that he possesses in this work is related to uterus. But to me, this is a satire because I think people pay too much attention to the topic of gender.
所以就所以观众他们的反应就是他们会去设限，包括这件作品受邀请，参加很多什么。 女艺术家展，他们反正有很多这种女艺术家展，他们想要这件作品去参展，所以观众反应也是很有意思的。But
the audience of this work set limits to this work, so I was invited to a lot of the female artists themed exhibitions, and the interesting reaction to the work was very surprising to me.
然后虽然我没有参加任何一个这个女艺术家展，因为我觉得。 以性别为分类的这种展览也是我不太特别能理解，因为当你一个人在创作的时候，你其实不会在乎是自己是谁，或者是男的女的哪个国家，或者是自己到底是不是人类，不会以这样子的前提去做作品。
So I didn't participate in any of the shows about female artists because I don't want to category myself as a female artist, because when you're making art, you don't really think about who you are, you don't think about your gender, whether you're female or male, you don't think about which country you come from, you don't also think about all the attitude issues, you're just creating art.
我觉得大家就是自己所有人在自己独立思考的时候，应该也没有太多这样的前提吧。
So when you're independently thinking or contemplating, you probably don't have that pre-limitation to yourself either.
然后子宫战士他有还有一个分，就是一个分支的作品，是做了一个 cosplay， 然后我邀请了日本的一个艺术家合作。然后让他担任子宫战士这样一个角色做了一个 cosplay。
There is extended work that I created in addition to Udurusman. I invited. It was created under the cosplay culture of Japanese animation. I invited a cosplay player in from Japan.
然后他本人就是一个没有性别的人，他把自己的生殖器去掉了，但是他也不想做男的或者做女的，他说他就是想做一个人类。
So he became asexual, that artist. He cut off his genitals, and he wanted to be a pure human instead of a man or a female.
所以就是找他合作，就可能代表了我对于这些作品的立场吧。
I invited this artist because of my core concept of the work. That was my position.
I think that also kind of come back to the notion of Mandela a little bit, because the body that you rendered in the video is also kind of without any sexual markers too, right? Even though the face kind of look like you, but the hairstyle kind of look like yours, but it doesn't have to be you. great. I think Barbara touched upon this concept of collaboration within your work as well. In our previous conversation, you also mentioned that you don't think your art is for art viewers in many ways. You said that kind of you have a wider range of audience. So maybe you can talk a little bit about your distribution of your art and also the audience and collaborations with scientists or researchers or computer game companies.
对，我觉得就是观众群还是挺有意思的，就是因为我基本上会把我的 video 都放在我的 Vimeo 上，然后所以说有一些 video 它的点击量会非常大，然后这些人他们并不是艺术观众。
So the audience group that we are talking about here is very interesting to me as well. I basically put all my art onto Vimeo, and some of the video get really high views, and they are not particularly art audiences.
我觉得现在就是好像很多很多观众基本上都是这样，很多艺术家他们的观众也是这样子的吧。
I guess that's also the case for many other artists.
这就是一个全球化的现象，不像在很多以前，就是上一代艺术家，他们的观众就是西方的一些艺术观众。
So I think this is a globalized phenomenon that last generation of artists, their audience is the westernized art audience.
我不知道这样说会不会冒犯，但是
I don't know if that was offending to anybody.
但是反正就现在有网络，大家看什么都可以。
But right now we have the internet, so you can view anything anywhere.
And also, I just want to jump in to say, you know, one of the things that inspired me to do this research is I was trying to figure out how we got from Zhang Gaogang to Lu Yang. Like, this leap seems amazing and seems to be two centuries in between them, not 20 years in between them. And so,the difference between the generation of Chinese artists that emerged in the 1990s and their concerns, and they dealt very much with their Chinese identity, partially because they were the first generation of Chinese artists sort of emerging into the world, and so it was sort of thrust on them to think about Chinese identity. Whereas now we get a younger generation that's thinking aboutall different kinds of issues, and the last thing on their mind is whether they're expressing a Chinese identity. I mean, we saw this work, it's obviously the work of a Chinese artist, but the concerns and the interests are far different than those of a generation that emerged in the 1990s.
Right. Yeah. When we talk next, I think I still want to go back to the question of collaboration, because I think that's also very different from the previous generation. There is very little collaboration within the artist or even with other disciplinaries. So this is, I think, something that Luyang, you can maybe help us to figure out since when you started collaborating with outsiders.
我2009年那时候在学校里面，然后可能想做一些我觉得很酷的装置，但是没有钱做。然后我就把一些想法画在了一个图表上面，然后这一套作品叫做寻求合作的一个作品系列。然后最后真的找到了合作方，就。我之前有一个作品，就是用那个电流刺激已经死掉的青蛙的坐骨神经，然后做了一个音乐盒，那个作品在网络上的点击量很大，那个就是那一个系列寻求合作的，然后找到了合作方之后的一个结果。
So, I think by 2009, I was still at school. I was thinking about this cool installation that I want to make, but I had zero money.So I put all the ideas down into a graph, and I started talking about this series of work as the Seeking Collaboration series. And you see the frog piece that I made under the name of Recreation, the Underwater Zombie Frog Ballet. It was a part of collaboration. I seeked out two different parties, and I finally got to made it.
然后就是另外就是合作对于我来说，我非常喜欢艺术之外的一些领域，我觉得他们的反正就非常厉害，我觉得很多方面真的要比当代艺术要厉害很多。
The other reason I seek collaboration is because I like different disciplines beyond arts, and I think they are a lot cooler than modern art in many ways.
然后就是我觉得我自己对，然后我说实话，我觉得我自己的智商不是很够去真的做，比如说当一名医生或者是去做其他的一些事业。然后但是艺术给我带来的好处就是我可以做任何自己想做的事情，然后在这个过程中就需要很多合作。
So I don't consider my IQ is high enough to become any other career such as medical doctor. But the advantage of art is because it lets me take the advantage of all different disciplines and that I want to talk about. I can create anything that I want to create. And then during that process, I need collaborations from other disciplines.
Great. Do you want anything to add, Barbara, on that topic?
I just think if she's smart enough to interact with neuroscientists, she's probably smart enough to be a neuroscientist. but I think it's funny that what comes out of it is these artworks.
Right. I mean, there is something interesting because in your earlier work, you were working with patients or frogs, you know, there are real objects, but the more recent one, they became more just kind of digital rendered, digital objects. So maybe you can talk a bit more about that this kind of the keyword of simulation, which I picked upon, which is kind of interesting because you talk about these DBS and those kind of programs. It's a simulation, but not actually programmed with real humans' bodies. So I mean, that's kind of an interesting thing. Personally, I want to know more about the kind of transition from previous work and more recent work.
就是我觉得我的作品里面可实施的部分和不可实施的部分，它们都掺杂在一起。就比如刚才那个 DBS 技术，它已经是非常成熟的一种脑科学，就是手术，大脑手术的一种技术。但是你不可能在真实的人的身上去实验，所以。比如说现在的 3D 技术，那些电脑技术给我带来的好处，就是在这边可以看到，可以虚拟很多可能性， 但是这些虚拟的过程中，它也是建立在一些已经现实的一个基础上。
So are there a lot of doable and not doable parts of my work? So for example, the DBS technique that we saw in the video is already available to the current medical world. However, there is only a limitation of what you can experiment on, the real objects. And then the 3D techniques in computers and the digital new media gave me the freedom to create more possibilities based on the real and technology that is in the real world.
So Barbara, we kind of also talked about how we want to, you know, connect her to Zhang Peili as well, not just Zhang Xiaogang, because Zhang Peili is her teacher. So maybe you can help us there.
Well, I think it's really interesting what Zhang Peili, who's the pioneer video artist in China, first artist to use video in China, has set up quite the experimental situation at the China Academy in Hangzhou. And I met, and doing my research, I met numerous artists who graduated under the tutelage of Zhang Peili. And what was great about the way he taught them was that he didn't impose on them that they needed to make work like his. They could pursue whatever they were doing. And I think it surprises people sometimes to see how advanced the education in China is that it produces artists like this, because I think that Americans tend to think we have the most advanced education system, but certainly what's going on at China Academy is quite advanced, and the technology available to the students is quite advanced. But I think what's interesting is that if we just compare her work to Zhang Peili's work, when Zhang Peili started, he made wonderful work using the barest minimum video equipment. It's like often endurance works, often documenting an action that he does over and over and over again, but basically he had a video camera and very little else to edit with or develop the work from. Then we get to somebody like Liu Yang, and just because of the technological advances of the last 10 years, she has a complete movie studio going on in her studio. I mean, she has access to working with animators. She's doing the animation. She can do all the editing. She can create everything in the computer. So the difference just in the technology between works that were made in China in the 1990s to works that are being made now is really remarkable.
And even though, I think, and Zhang Peili, when he made his early videos in the 80s, that was the cutting edge technology too, right? So like he was you, basically, using the most kind of sought after, you know, technological objects. Great. I think we can come back to kind of the ideas of maybe taboo. I don't know if this is something people raise it to you, because there are a lot of, you know, using the funeral, and then there's kind of abjection with the body in your work. I don't know if this is an issue that you discuss in the book, but I'm very curious to know if you know, that came across your mind.
对，我觉得就是很我的一些作品里面碰触到，尤其是中国人不想碰触的那些观念，就比如死亡和疾病之类的，或者是一些负面的一些内容。就是其实我遇到的这些问题还好哎，而且尤其我还收获了一些老年观众。
So my work touches a lot of the Chinese, the concept that Chinese wouldn't touch easily, such as death and disease, a lot of the negative concepts. But what surprised me was I got a bunch of senior audience in China.
就是其实我觉得这也是一种没有在这个限制里面，我不觉得就是就年龄和年龄的这个差距有什么好鄙视或者是有高有低这样子。 因为每一个人都他都可能活那么长一段，只是你如果说要从三维世界观去想的话，那如果说时间是一根直线，那每一个人出现在这个直线的不同的位置而已。
So that's also part of the reality that I always think about, that age and the age gap may not be as important as we think. If you consider time as a linear concept, then we are just appearing at the different points of that line.
所以我觉得就是不管是佛陀他在2500年前提出的一些观念，所以你把它拿到现在来看的话，它就是人类的就是比如说本性，或者是它发展过程中它所遇到的所有的问题，在2500年前佛陀他也说过，所以我觉得人类的发展它不是通过技术来体现，也不是通过科技来体现，而是要通过你怎么样去理解这个世界去体现。
So if you look at Buddhism, that a lot of the concept that they were talking about 2,500 years ago was still the same concept that we talk about today. So the core concept of human being and also humanity is the same. And the human development that we look at is not probably from the technology development, it's probably how we view the world.
所以我觉得就是作品里面的核心还是很重要的，就比如说你现在看到一个东西，它是技术性很高的话，可能再过50年这样子的技术它已经被淘汰了，那这样子的作品它我觉得它的价值就比刚出来的时候要少了。
So I think the technology part of the artwork is such as for example if you look at a workthat is very high-tech right now, but in 50 years, the technology that they use in that piece may not be valuable as such, and that value of that piece will decline in that way.
不好意思，我扯，好像扯远了。
I'm going a little bit far away.
No, but I think you're definitely right. It's not about applied technology, it was never about that. It's really about what is technology, or what is the technology thinking. I think one thing, like, you know, I don't want to go there, but I feel like kind of have to go there, is the mind-body divide that you talk about in a Buddhist term. Maybe help us more to understand your understanding of that mind-body divide.
我觉得就是这个概念很可以从现在那个 VR 技术去理解。你可以就是
We can try to understand that concept from the VR technology.
或者是游戏。
Or gaming.
就如果说你很沉浸一个游戏，尤其是它是一个非常好的游戏，它可以让你忘记你自己是谁。
So if you're very into a game, especially a good game, then that game will allow you to forget who you are.
然后就是比如说你在游戏里面，我觉得它很有意思的一点，你可以切换视角嘛，你可以看到你自己的手，看到你在驾驶一个车，或者是你可以把这个手的这个第一视角给切换掉，然后你可以通过这种虚拟的这种身体的替换，你可以让你的灵魂进入不同的身体。
There are different viewpoints in gaming that is interesting to me.For example, you can look at your own hands, and also you can look at the fact that you're driving a car, and the different digital viewpoints allow me to.
可以，你的灵魂可以换不同的身体。
Oh, so like you feel like you're so controlled to different bodies, because of the viewpoints.
Perfect.
I just want to touch on one thing, which is.One of the most remarkable things about Liu Yang is the way she presents her work, because she very rarely shows it as just a projected video. She often creates total environments to put the work in, and I mean total, like the walls covered, the ceilings covered, video arcade games coming off the walls, LED signs. The piece that she made for the Shanghai Biennial this year,is really remarkable in that she completely commandeered a room of the biennial, and yet it becomes the centerpiece of the whole biennial because the way that she just jam-packed everything you can think of into this room, and yet it all goes together so well. And so I think the environments are really interesting.
Definitely, and different types. It's not just video, it's video game, it's cosplay, sculpture. So maybe tell us more about the Shanghai Biennial project for those that who.
就是那是一个新的作品，叫 Material World Night， 就气世界骑士。 就是我把这个词翻译成英语是 material， 因为它是可以你们可以摸到的那种物质的一个层面的东西。
So the piece is called Material World Night because I translated the Chinese into English for the fact that the material is something we can touch.
然后就是佛教里面它把这个世界分为有情世界和气世界，有情世界就是我们。 的灵魂，它觉得这个就是我们意识所存在的一个世界，然后气它就是承载这个意识的一个载体。So
in Buddhism there are two different worlds. One is the our mind.
友情应该是和不知道怎么翻译友情世界。有就是有情义的友情。
Emotional world. So in Buddhism, there is one emotional world, and there is another world that has that contains that emotional world.
所以就是，然后这个世界里面我设定了有四个角色，就是第一个角色它是，就是假设里面可能是第一次讲述一个故事。 然后这里面的四个角色是在未来，它有三种不同的可能性。第一种是可以随意篡改基因的一个人。So
I set two four different characters with three different characters with three different possibilities.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then the first one is the character could change their own DNA.
然后就是这个角色他的一个特殊的 DNA， 我指出了就是他可以去除自己脑部的梭状回，他可以捣毁梭状回，我不知道英语怎么说，但是他是我们可以辨别人们身份的一个种族在大脑里面。So
the technique this character possess is to delete the neural. In your brain to detect people's identity.
就是说，打个比方，举个例子，就是说你我们人类看猴子，觉得猴子是长得一样的。
For example, we look at monkeys as human, we think all monkeys look the same.
然后其实猴子看我们也觉得我们长得一样。
But if you go into the viewpoint of a monkey, they probably look at humans and think all humans look the same.
所以就是只有在人类的狭隘的意识里面，他们。 他们会区分，就是每一个人的不同，然后就是把这个分别的念头就把它放大。Only
in human we see the difference among us, between different humans, and then we enlarge that difference in our mind.
然后就是这个人，他可以把他就是他的基因里面把他的梭状回给敲损之后，他可以看众生平等。
So after deleting that particular DNA, this character can look at everybody as if we are all equal.
然后第二个型号是那个 exoskeleton.
The second character is called exo.
它是人类和机械合成的一个强化的身体。
The second character is a human and machine combination. That made human body better.
然后就是其实这一个角色，我是和日本的一个机器人公司合作，他们是做那个外骨骼的。So
I collaborated with a company in Japan that
they build the exoskeleton.
They build yes.
然后第三个就是 AI robots.
And the third one was AI robot.
所以就整个剧情里面，他们一直在互相争斗，说谁创造了谁，或者是谁可以控制谁这样的一个概念。
So the entire plot was who has control over others, who created others, and then who controls others.
然后在这个他们争斗的过程中，他们突然领悟到，他们是处于三维世界的生物。
during the fighting process, all of the three characters suddenly realize they live in the 3D world.
然后他们意识到他们是在这个气世界，所以这个气世界的概念就在这里面出现了。
And they realize that they live in a world that contains the emotional world.
Not emotional, material world.
So even for AI, they all have their containers.
然后就是在里面有一个观念，就是如果说你还在探讨时间和空间的话，那如果说是不是如果有可能，这整个世界它就是无始无终的。
So if we're still talking about time and space, is it possible that the entire world has no ending or beginning?
因为就是你是被困在自己的这个身体里面，所以你会有这个概念去探讨这个时间和空间。
Because you're caged in your physical body and you have the concept of time and space.
所以差不多就是这样子一个观点，反正很长的，里面探讨了各种各样的东西。
So I discuss a lot of topics in that work.
包括一些那个二次元的一些概念，就比如说为什么就是人类在创造机器人的时候，他们是类人的一个形态，他们为什么会有胸部？
So including some animation concepts such as when people are creating a 2D character, why do they have breasts?
If you create the AI robot, the robots still have the breast, like the Sophia.
All great questions. I think we're time to open up and already saw their eager hands to want to ask questions. So is there a mic around or you can shout out
just,
a question?
Just speak loud, please. And identify yourself first, please.
Okay, sure. Yeah, my name is Steve, and I'm the young professional leader. My name is also in Chinese too as well. I was first attracted to today's event by the name Video Game to Art. Yeah, I am a video game. I was a video game player, and I will be one in the future when I have time. Just no time. But I want to ask that, what are some video games that influence your work? What are some video games that you play? I used to play like World of Warcraft, Diablo, even Xianjian. But I'm curious about how your video game influences your work.
我觉得我很喜欢的一个游戏是Asrasras.
Okay, I have no idea.
Asrasras.
That's my favorite video game.
就是它的这个世界观，就是它打破了很多各种各样的局限。它可以说里面的佛陀它是机械构成的，或者是在宇宙里面，就是它可以在宇宙里面飞行。就是反正这个游戏里面的设定我是非常喜欢的。
Is it a Japanese game?
Yeah, Japanese game.
So I like the world wheel set up in this game. In this game, there is a lot of limitations. There are a lot of limitations that were broken. For example, if you are talking about Buddha, you can have a Buddha that is robotic and flying in the space.
就是它其实，就是它那个设定很好玩，它可以把很传统的一些形象带入到像高达一样的这样的一个层面去表现，然后它没有任何的限制在这个游戏里面。
So they basically disregard a lot of the traditional settings in our world, and they brought a human into a lot of the Gundam to style.
就是一个Evangelion这样子的大机器人，a
large robot.
我一直有一个梦想，我就是想可以在，可以实现真的有一个自己可以操控一个大型机器人，然后在宇宙翱翔。
So my dream is to control a large robot and fly in the space.
所以就是把那个游戏里面有我所有喜欢的元素。
And that game allows me all these different elements.
然后那个 Asura 它是一个在日本的东密，因为是从唐代的这个密宗传过去的一个密教，所以现在在中国这个唐密已经差不多没有了，但是在那个日本就留下来的。然后它里面有一个非常重要的形象，就是阿修罗。但是阿修罗在那个佛教的六道轮回里面，它说的是介于人道和天道中间的一个层次，就是它既有神通，但是它又有烦恼。 就是好像就是一个不完美的神，就是它是一个超越人类，但是它和人类一样拥有各种七情六欲的一个状态。So
the game is set up in the Tang Dynasty Buddhism that in China is already lost, but it has kept its tradition in Japan. So in Asura, which is in Buddhism a character between human and God. They're basically imperfect God who has the same emotions as human and same problems with human. However, they are beyond human.
Okay, to you first and then second.
Okay, great, thanks. So I wanted to return to the question that Barbara opened up with at the beginning, which was, and this is really a question for both Barbara first, I think, and then Lu Yang, but I'm really curious about the relationship to politics. And, you know, if you think about the artists of the 1980s in China, including Zhang Peili, including a little bit later Zhang Xiaogang, but particularly the artists in the 80s, they were filled with idealism and also, you know, so their work, they were very connected to what was happening politically in China and very much part of the kind of opening up of China and testing the limits and had a very kind of, you know, a lot of their art was critical of the political system in whatever direct or indirect ways, but it seems like there's no politics in your art. And so I'm really curious, and maybe Barbara, you can talk a little bit, back to the question of how do we get from Zhang Xiaogang, you know, to Lu Yang? I mean, what is it that changed in China that now this art doesn't have any politics in it at all? Can you talk a little bit about that evolution that you've seen in knowing all these artists and watching China? And then, Lu Yang, you can talk about your relationship to politics.
That's a really good question. And one thing is that we have to keep in mind is the artists who reached adulthood in the 80s and the 90s have all lived through the Cultural Revolution, which had a profound effect on them and everyone of their generation. And the thing that's interesting about China is that all these people have lived through the Cultural Revolution, yet there's no public discussion of the Cultural Revolution. And it's completely eliminated from newspapers or textbooks. So it was left to the artists to express the feelings for the whole nation about what that experience was about. And so, but I think that for the younger generation, what they lived through was not a political revolution, but an economic revolution. They lived through the opening up of China and the influx of Western products and a complete cultural revolution on a different level. And so many of their works are responding to that. The rise of the internet, the access to art movements from all over the world, the access to information from all over the world, that is what they're reacting to. But I also have to say this, that what is or is not political is a very interesting question in China. Because, for example, Lu Yang said she really loves horror movies and ghost movies. And you know, that ghost movies that have ghosts in it is censored in China. Horror movies are not permitted in China. So, I mean, it becomes political that she's dealing with the kind of way that she's dealing with the body, given what are the parameters of popular culture in China. So I see her work as highly political, but I don't know what she thinks.
我觉得就是可以这样说，就是如果说你硬要说自己没有政治立场的话，那其实你还是会有立场。如果从一个很笼统的范围去套的话，是这样子的。
So I think even if I say I don't have a political position in my artwork, but still I'm taking a position anywhere, that is my political position, I guess.
但是就是我觉得对于我们的理解来说，就是我们觉得政治可能是和政府它的一些行为，还有比如说刚才说的文化大革命之类的这些是，像这样子对我们来说是政治。
So our concept of politics is about, for example, cultural revolution or related to the government, and for us that means politics.
然后我觉得就是像我对于政治没有兴趣，可能是因为我没有遭遇到就是上一代艺术家他们所，他们那个时候所遭受到的压迫。就如果说你是换位思考的话，我觉得那个确实非常的可怕。I
have no interest in politics because maybe because I didn't live through the experiences that last generation of artists lived through, and if you put yourself into their viewpoint, that must have been very horrible.
然后另外一点，我觉得好像即使我做很多和政治有关的东西，但是也没有办法帮助正在受难的，就是正在被这些东西折磨的一些人民，或者比如说在中国，它是一个两极分化非常严重的国家，就是它我们看到它发展的很厉害，然后但是它也会有很多非常多不公正的一些地方。
So even though I do anything about politics in my work, it may not help the people who are oppressed by politics right now. So for example, in China is a very unequal country. So even if you look at China as a prosperity that has developed fast enough in the past two decades, but it doesn't mean that people are not having the same life in China.
但是我也想做一些，如果可以的话，为这个社会做一些贡献。但是我觉得可能不是通过艺术。
If possible, I want to contribute to that society. However, that may not be through art.
或者是我觉得，如果说我利用了这些受难的人，他们的一些主题去一些话题去做作品的话，我可能我觉得应该你要从自己的艺术所得里面去付出一部分回报给他们。Or
if I take advantage of the people who are being politically oppressed. And make art and get profits from that. Maybe I should contribute part of that profit to the people who are being oppressed by politics.
Yes, thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
I like the video very much. Even though by age, I'm more towards the traditional type of representative art. My question, though, is to both is. And is Shanghai, in Shanghai, is the artist somewhat freer than, say, the main part of China, Beijing or other areas? And secondly, do you have any opinion on Ai Weiwei? Both representational, but at the same time, quite conceptualist. Abstract.
我觉得他就是很勇敢啊。Very brave. If you didn't hear, very brave. 所以我觉得就像我肯定不敢啊。我觉得如果我这样做的话，然后我就完蛋了，没有办法在国内展展我的作品了。I'm
finished in China, and then won't be able to exhibit any of my work.
然后我还是很想展作品的，然后我也不想住在外国，我想。
I don't want to live abroad and I want to live in China.
I have a question. Wanted to ask about, because a lot of your work does deal with like biology, body, and death, and it's very prominent in the video that you show. And I want to ask your thoughts on ideas of death and immortality, like the relationship between death and immortality, because for two reasons. First, because immortality or being immortal is also a very big topic in sort of the technological advancement, also the end point of humanity. Like if we do achieve being immortal, then somehow everything has to be rewrite, right? And history and everything. And second is, I think it's related to your idea of the mind and body separation, because ultimately you do talk a lot about how computer game could provide you to be kind of having inhabited in other bodies, but then in your work at the Shanghai Banyu, even these things are sort of in the emotional rhyme as you described, they're still kind of doomed to have to be materialized as an object holder or whatever. So it's like also in the talk of discourse of immortality, that there is this possibility that we could all be digitized. So we can all become this sort of digits and somehow assign a new shell. And then this is the concept of being immortal. So I just want to hear you talk about it. Maybe just your understanding. It doesn't need to be like really complicated or
anything.
Can you translate again? Oh, this is what I want to ask you. You talk about your work, you
对于就是永生这个概念是怎么想的？That's essentially it。我觉得这个问题很有意思，就是我觉得不是我一个人在考虑这个问题，就即使中国人他是对死亡是有禁忌，但他们肯定会想，我觉得不想就不是人了，这个，就是只是他们在开心的时候他们就忘记了，但是他们碰到问题的时候他们肯定会害怕，所以死亡是一个非常刺激的一个话题，就是你就比如说作品。 里面有这样子的话题的话，可能也会有人会去想看，然后关于永生，就比如说你刚才说，是不是人的精神数字化了，他就可能达到永生？我觉得这个是，在我的概念里面，我觉得这是不一样的，就是我觉得就是克隆人，他是有自己的意识的，但是你的数字拷贝的一个人，他就是有两种人，就是两个人，他完全是两个人。 就比如说之前黑镜有一集里面说，他把一个人的意识全部都上载到那个网络上面，然后他就不停的去折磨那个人的意识，然后来满足自己的就是对于这个惩罚的这个满足，但我觉得就是原本的那个人他的意识已经不在这边了，然后你去折磨了一个他的副本，但是这个副本他可能还是有自己的意识的。 就我不知道意识是不是能被copy，但是比如说打比方，如果我现在把你的记忆还有所有大脑去复制一遍，然后放到另外一个克隆人的身体里面，你觉得你和他是一个人还是你们是两个人？我自己这样去幻想的话，我觉得肯定是两个人，就是他没有办法去经历你所感知的这些痛苦或者怎么样。 比如说，让他带你去受惩罚，那是可以的。但是，让他翻译一下。哦，可怜。So
I guess it's interesting for me that death and immortality. I guess if it is in our human nature to talk about immortality, because if we don't think about death, we're not really human beings anymore. And the fear about death is always existence for everybody, I guess. And in your happy moments, you forget about it. And then when problems come, you're scared of death, of course. And I don't think the idea of digitized cell is the same as immoral, because if we talk about clone bodies, and if you put your mind, your experience, your memories into a clone body, are we one person or two person? So in Black Mirror, there is an episode talking about mind and body. There was a person whose mind got uploaded online, and then another person in the episode was torturing that mind, and then stopped. So the original person's experience, the memory, and everything has been copied into the second person, which is the copy of the original person. So are we talking about one person or two person? In my experience, I wouldn't think that is the same. So I would say a clone body with your memories and also your experiences would be too, because that person has never lived through your experiences.
Oh, how behind.
But of course, we can have ourselves replaced in any cases, such as for the punishment reasons.
然后我觉得就是比如说在佛教里面它有一句话叫活在当下嘛，就是这个当下只有你自己可以感受，然后。 就但是我觉得从远去看的话，如果说，那你也可以把这个世界看作成你和他人无二无别，就看你从哪一个方面去看。就比如说你去理解他的时候，他们说你要从世俗地，他说那就是世俗的这个价值观去理解，还是圣意地，就是你已经超过这个三维的这个世界，比如说你上升到三维以上或者是什么无穷的、无穷无尽的那个。 层次的时候，那可能你的那个看法是不一样的。
So, in Buddhism, there is a saying called living in the presence. The presence only experienced by yourself is not experienced by anybody else. And in the long run, if we look at life in that way, then maybe there is another Buddhism saying, say, is that you and others are not different at all.
世俗地和圣义地，世俗就是我们现在的理解层面，然后圣义就是我们超越现在我们这个三维层面。
And there are two different understanding of our world. One is reality, such as we live in and know we experience the current world. The other one is beyond our world, beyond 3D and beyond anything that we can experience right now.
与其他人都一样，就比如说他有一个概念是说一个毛孔里面他有一千个世界，就是他的意思就是说，就是你超越三维的时空概念去理解这个世界。当然，但是我们现在我觉得很难去，肯定很难去那个去这样子理解。但是当你超越了自己这样子一个，比如说我觉得他有其他维度的话，那个时候你才能理解。
So there is another saying, like there are 1,000 worlds in one cell, that basically saying that if we cross beyond the special limitation of our current world, maybe we can understand something differently.
Okay, two more questions.
Yes. I had a question about your...
Can you introduce yourself?
Oh yeah, I'm Mitchell Dong, I'm a businessman. I'm interested in your clothing and what you're wearing. So if you tell us about the hat, the shoes, the earring, the pants, the shirt you're wearing.
就是就是 I wear something I like. That's my taste.
But you've designed clothing.
I gave up. That's a complex.
Two more questions. Sure.
Hi, I'm Anna. Thank you so much for coming. Can you elaborate on the technical expertise of being a contemporary artist? Because to express those ideas, you need to stay up to date, you know, Unity, C sharp, whatever technologies that you're using to express it, and what's your learning process, and how much time do you actually spend learning AR Kit or something else, whatever you want to use that.
Mm-hmm. 就其实我在大学时候各种各样技术都学过一点点，但是可能学完就忘记了。
A little bit of everything in college, but after that, I forgot.
然后，但是我还知道怎么样去和那些技术人员沟通，所以我觉得。
But I still remember how to talk and communicate with all the expertise.
然后但是一开始很多作品都自己做的是，就在网上学一下就会了吧，因为你很想把它做出来，然后你就会去学相应的这些东西，你只要学那部分就可以，你不用学所有的东西。
So at the beginning, I was making all the art by myself, and I was basically learning by making. And whenever I'm interested in something, I really want to make it, I would just learn whatever it takes in order to make that, only that part. You just Google it and learn it.
就当你还没有学的时候，你就会觉得哇，这太难了。但是其实你一旦进去，就觉得还可以了。
If you look at from the outside before you learn it, then you're like, oh, this is so difficult. But after you actually learn it, it's not that much.
Yes, I just want to kind of ask.
Can you introduce yourself, please?
Sorry, I'm Curator from Asia. And I'm still dealing with a lot of art and technology artworks, and including Luya. And you talked about once about your experience when you're young at the hospital. Like, you know, because she often brings all these medical technologies and also subject matters. So, and also that part of your experience in the hospital may think of you that as a kind of subject matter. So if you can elaborate more about that, I think it will help people. It's not only from the virtual world or video game, it's real about like as a human being person.
就是我觉得其实我小时候有那个哮喘 asthma, 所以我基本上每天晚上都没有办法睡，我只要一去，一闻到那个消毒水的味道我就好了。
So I had asthma when I was a kid. Every night I couldn't sleep because of it. And then as soon as I smelled the hospital smell, it became better.
所以就是，但是我每天晚上都基本上比较严重的时候，每天晚上都可以看到急诊室的这个状况。
So when it was severe, I could see ER every night.
然后就是可以看到小朋友跟我年纪一样的小朋友，他们也可以得很重的病。 比如说他没有腿啊，或者是就是快要濒临死亡的那种情况。So
I saw a lot of kids of my age dying, such as or with very severe disease, for example, no leg, or kids who were dying.
就是因为中国，我觉得中国的，就如果说这边有华人的话，你们应该知道中国的这个急诊室的情况非常的可怕。 就其实就我觉得很就可以用人间地狱去描述。So
if there is any Chinese person in this room, you must know that the ER in China is very scary. We can describe it as a living hell.
就好像在那个时候，就是你如果说是一辈子你非常保有自己的自尊尊严的人，你可以在那边完全卸下尊严，然后躺在一个角落里面，然后等别人去。 去救助，或者是就完全已经没有自尊的这种感觉。So
all your self-esteem basically was lost, and then you were waiting for someone to rescue you from the fire
afterward.所以，反正我觉得这些对我的感触还是很大的，所以就是可能很早就开始去接触这件事情，就养成了习惯，就喜欢去思考这样。
That has a severe impact in my life, and then because you touched that topic at a very young age of your life, you became very used to thinking about that or such topics.
That's it? Okay, so there's a reception afterwards. Thank you.
They know exactly what they want. Okay.